Okay, so good evening everybody. Welcome to lecture 5 of quantum computation, EH870. Now in the previous lectures, right, so we've just been talking about the very basics of quantum mechanics, that you have states and operators, and what is the notion of a vector space. What is the notion of an adjoint of a vector, right? So what is the tensor product? Then what is linear independence? We have also talked a little bit about entanglement, if I'm not mistaken, or maybe not. We'll talk about that later. Soon, I've talked about the quantum circuit model,
So could you repeat the part? You got disconnected, so we could.
Yeah, no, that's what I. Okay, no. So I said I talked about tensor products. What part did you miss? I said I talked about tensor products. I'm just going over the things that we have covered in the previous classes. I'm not saying anything new as yet, okay? And orthogonal basis, then the notion of projective equivalence, that states which are related by okay, I really don't know what the fuck is wrong with Zoom. It's really pissing me off. Like I'm paying these people money and they're still screwing me over. Okay, so sorry for the unparliamentary language, but sometimes things are just okay. So then talked about the circuit model of quantum computation, and matrix representations of operators and vectors. Okay, one second. Actually, let me I'll switch to my mobile connection on my tablet. I think maybe that will make things a little bit better. Can you see my screen?
No, sir. No, sir.
Okay, so I've talked about the circuit representation of operators of quantum circuits, and then the matrix elements. What is the notion of a matrix element of an operator? Just give me one second, okay? I'll be right back. Okay, and so this is this is the matrix element of an operator. It's basically just the operator acting sandwich between the basis vectors of your vector space. Okay, and so these are called the matrix elements. And then in yesterday's lecture, I also gave you Thursday's lecture, I gave you what I think is a useful and intuitive notion of what a matrix element measures. What is it a measure of? And it is a measure of how likely is it that a state psi will transition into a state phi when acted upon by an operator A. Okay, then you have this state operator correspondence. This is very important. We'll be using it all the time, which is that you can build an operator out of any state or out of any pair of states. Okay, by this using this notation, which is the ket adjoint ket notation. And then this quantity, the sum over all of these operators, where phi I is the basis vector, is the identity operator. So this is a statement of completeness. It is another way of saying that any state psi in your vector space can be written as a linear combination of your basis states. Okay. All right. Then again, this is just the circuit representation of the same thing. Right, just these diagrams here. And then I talked about this Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure. I explained it to you in the case of two vectors. So what you do is you just take, if you have any two vectors which are not necessarily orthogonal, you just subtract the parallel part of one vector from the other, and that gives you two vectors which are perpendicular to each other. And one can repeat that procedure if you have n different vectors which are not necessarily orthogonal to each other. Let's say this here W1 to WB, you want an orthogonal basis consisting of vectors V1 to VB. Then, by the way, is my voice coming through clearly or is it breaking up? Can you please tell me? Hello? Okay, yeah, so we have this orthogonal basis, and I can't really do anything about the frequent disconnection. It's not under my control. Either it's Zoom or it's something else. So you just have to bear with it. And so what you do is you start with let me just try one thing, okay? Give me a second. I don't know if it will make any difference now. So we'll see if this is any better. So the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure is basically you start with, you take the first vector as your orthogonal vector, then the second vector V2, you find the second vector V2 by subtracting off the part of W1, which is orthogonal to V1, okay? So let me give you a bit of a diagrammatic sort of idea of what's going on. So you have a non-orthogonal basis. WP. And you want to generate out of this an orthogonal basis which is some set of vectors v1 to vd. Okay, so first of all, you set v1 to be equal to w1 normalized. Okay, and this is just the norm or the length of w1. Right, then you take v2. So what do? You take v, you take w1 and you subtract from w1 the part which is parallel, the part of w1 which is parallel to v1. Okay, minus whatever, I'll call it something like this, parallel w1 v1. This just means okay. All right. So I'm back as usual. I think this is the fourth or fifth time I've been disconnected. I have lost count. Unfortunately, there is no such thing as accountability when it comes to Zoom. It's just a company that is sitting in San Jose in the US, and they don't have anything, any number you can call or any person you can talk to. And we don't have an institutional subscription because our institute is our institute, and so and you have an individual subscription, and really they don't give a damn about individual subscribers. I guess we don't really matter, so they can do whatever they want. Anyways, so we take w1 to be this normalized v1 to be this normalized w1, then v2 is w1 minus the parallel part, the part of v1 which is parallel to w1. Okay, and then you normalize it. So normalizing means that you divide by the same vector, by the length of this vector, right? And then similarly to find
sir, I think in v2 that should be w2, sir.
Yes. Yeah, W2. Yeah, thanks. And then similarly, V3, now what you have to do is you take W3, then you subtract the part which is parallel to V2, and also the part which is parallel to V1, right? And then you normalize it. So this is the procedure. Okay, so I hope that, and if you want to write it down graph somewhat schematically, we can also write it like this. Let me see. So V1 is just W1. And then V2 is W2 minus something, V3, W3. Then V3 is so these lines are going to get messy. I guess this is not a very elegant representation, but it sort of gives you an idea of what's going on. And so VD will be like this. And then you would have a line from each one of the previous vectors. So these diagonal lines represent subtraction of the corresponding part of the corresponding parallel part. Okay. All right. I'll leave the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure here. I did ask you if to write a script, Python script. I don't know how many of you attempted that. So that we will come to that eventually. Okay. All right. Then what was the next thing that we were going to talk about? Okay. Okay. All right. So the next item on the list is something called the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. And this is a generalization of the sum rule for triangles, right? So you know that for a triangle which has three sides ABC, you know that AB is less than or equal to C, right? The length of A, any two sides has to be less than or sum of the length of any two sides has to be less than or equal to the side of the third length of the third edge. Okay, so the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, what is this statement? This is the following. Let's say I have two vectors v comma w, and I construct I take the inner product of v and w and take the length squared of this object. Okay, now what is the length squared of this object? Well, this is a complex number, so the length squared will just be vw multiplied by vw complex conjugate, right? And now the inner product has the property that you can write it that with the complex conjugation simply changes the two vectors, right? So this becomes the inner product of w. Okay, so we can write it in this. And the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality says that this object is always less than or equal to the product of the length of the two vectors. Okay, so let me just show you in slightly so if you want to talk about it in vector language, it is a statement that a dot b is or a dot b squared is always less than I would say the magnitude squared is always less than or equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B. Okay, or another way to write it is that Bn is squared is always less than or equal to A1 squared An squared times b1 squared bn squared. Okay, and this when is this equality achieved, right? This equality is achieved when a is equal to when a is equal to b, right? That is when when equality will hold. Otherwise, it will always be less than. Okay. So the proof of this is given in Nielsen and Chuang, and it uses this Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure. So what we do is you don't need to use the Gram-Schmidt procedure if you already have an orthonormal basis. So we'll just assume that we have an orthonormal basis. If you don't have one, then you use that procedure to construct an orthonormal basis. Okay, and this is our orthonormal basis of vectors, where I is some index, it goes from 1 to n. Okay, and now we know that this is the completeness relationship. right? The sum of these operators constructed from my orthonormal basis vectors is equal to 1. So all I need to do to prove this is the following. I take my one side of my inequality, which is the right hand side in the previous page, and I insert a copy of this identity in here. Okay, so I put V, and I just put the identity between the two, the ket and the adjoint ket of V, right? And then this identity I can write as V I V W. Okay. All right. Okay. And now this quantity is going to be so here we have a sum over all of these vectors I, right, which are the orthogonal basis vectors. And so this is going to be greater than or equal to right. And so how do we get the second step? To get the second step, what we say is we make the following assumption. So we have this basis, orthonormal basis I, right? So we assume, and we can always take this to be the case, that the first element of this basis, this ket 1, is just the length of just the normalized vector W. Okay? So then you can write this quantity. You can write it as V W W V divided by, okay, right? Because what I've done is I've just taken I is equal to 1. When I put I is equal to 1 over here, I will get W W and divided by this, right? That's just the expression over here. And then plus I is equal to 2 to n VI IV WW. Okay. So this is the expression that I had here. And now you can see one thing, that all the terms in this expression are positive, okay? Why is that? Because this object is the product of a complex number and its complex conjugate, right? So this is z squared, modulus squared. The inner product is always positive, definite. And this is also the sum complex number squared, right? So you can see that the left-hand side of this expression, which is this quantity, will always be greater than or equal to this expression, right? Because all the terms over here are positive definite, right? And so that's how we get this inequality. Okay, so we started from this expression, which is a product of the length of two vectors squared. We inserted a resolution of identity, completeness, and then using, setting one of the vectors to be the orthogonal basis. Sorry, there's too many interruptions here. We get this inequality. Okay, so I'll put this here in brackets. And what is this expression equal to now? This expression. So we have is greater than or equal to this expression. And here we can just cancel this W and we are left with our statement of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Okay, so again, this is just a statement that if you take the length of any two vectors and you multiply those lengths, this is always greater than or equal to right, the length of the first vector dotted with the second. Okay, this is also clear from the fact that if you look at A and B and theta, right? So what is A dot B? A dot B is length of A times length of B times cosine theta, right? And cosine theta is always between 0 and 1, right? So this quantity will always be less than or equal to the length of A times the length of B, right? Unless theta is equal to 0, in which case it becomes an equality. So this is a very important result, and it will, so you should know how to, you should know the statement of this result and also how to prove it. Okay, and there is more than one way to prove it. I think if you go and look in some mathematics books, you'll find many different ways of proving it, but this is the only one. Okay, sorry about this. I have to keep an eye on my data usage because I'm on mobile right now. Okay, now let's talk about eigenvectors and eigenvalues. All right, now most of you probably have seen, you know, what eigenvectors and eigenvalues are at some point or the other. But again, your memory might be hazy, right? So I'll just summarize a few useful facts. Okay, so I have some matrix A, and then what is the eigenvalue equation? The eigenvalue equation is written in this way. So this says that you have some vector, some operator acting on that vector, and it gives you the same vector multiplied by some number. And since this vector is associated with the number, we can also alternatively label the vector itself by this object, by this lambda. And so this is the eigenvalue and this is the eigenvector. So given any operator, right? So any operator, as long as it is non-degenerate, okay? So what is non-degenerate? I'll talk about that in a second. is completely determined if you know its eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Okay. So, and how do we solve this expression? Okay. So we solve it as follows. On the left, we have an operator acting on a vector. On the right, also we can put an operator, which is just the identity operator multiplied by lambda acting on the same vector. And now I can bring this to the left hand side and I get this expression over here, right? A minus lambda identity acting on V is zero, right? So this is a matrix now, right? As a simple example, we can look in two dimensions, okay? And we'll look at the Pauli Z matrix. So we can write it as sigma Z or as capital Z, and this is 1, 0, -1, okay? And if you want to write down this expression, we want to find its eigenvalues and eigenvectors, right? What do? We say Z minus lambda identity. So what is that? That is 1, 0, 0, -1, minus lambda times the identity, right? So this just becomes 1 minus lambda okay? So this is your matrix. Okay? And the solutions of this equation, right, are given by the requirement that the determinant of this matrix should be zero. Okay, so this determinant is called the characteristic function and so if you have any matrix, M, and the action of that matrix on some vector is zero, right? So that means that the determinant of that matrix must be equal to zero. So this is the matrix in question, right? And its determinant has to be equal to zero. So in this case, the determinant of the matrix Z minus lambda I is just a product of these diagonal elements. 1 minus lambda times 1 plus lambda, that's lambda square minus 1, is 0, right? So there are two solutions, lambda is equal to plus minus 1. These are the eigenvalues, okay? And the eigenvectors are easy to determine in this case. There are two eigenvectors. One eigenvector is the up state, which you can write as 1, 0. The other eigenvector is the down state, which you can write as 0, 1. This has eigenvalue plus 1, and this has eigenvalue minus 1. Okay? So again, if your matrices become large, then it becomes more and more difficult to calculate, to solve this eigenvalue equation. So you know, we use numerical tools. And another observation is the following, that this matrix over here, right? when we take this determinant, right, what does it look like? So this is A11 minus lambda, A22 minus lambda, and so on. Right? And all the other terms in the matrix are not affected. Only the diagonal terms get a contribution from the lambda, right? Now when I take this determinant, what is the highest power of lambda I will obtain? I will obtain a polynomial, right? So I will obtain a polynomial which I can write as Cn lambda n, Cn minus 1 lambda n minus 1, so on, right? The determinant will be a polynomial of degree n in lambda. It has to be. The highest power of lambda I will get is from this diagonal subfactor of the Hopewell matrix. And then from the other ones, the other minors, I will get the smaller powers, right? So, and this is equal to zero. This is my characteristic equation, right? And then we have something called the fundamental theorem of algebra, according to which an equation of a polynomial equation of degree n has polynomial equation of degree n has n roots, right? So the roots are the solutions of this equation. And they all don't need to be different. You can also have repeating roots and so on. And so there will be n eigenvalues, and corresponding to each eigenvalue, there will be an eigenvector. And again, there can be some, you can have a case where the eigenvectors can be the same, in which case we say that your matrix is degenerate. Okay, so a matrix is non-degenerate. The matrix is non-degenerate if it doesn't have any repeating eigenvalues. Okay, otherwise it's said to be degenerate. Okay. All right. Now, we come to a certain special kind of operator, which are very important, which are called Hermitian operators. And before that, actually, let me mention, I'll mention it in this only. So a Hermitian operator has the following property, that it is equal to its own adjoint. Okay. So A is equal to A transpose conjugate. Okay. Such operators are called Hermitian. Hermitian operators have a very nice property, which is that the eigenvalues of these operators are always real. Okay. So since they have, so the one thing is that the eigenvalues are always real. This is the first statement. And the second statement is that the eigenvectors of a Hermitian operator form an orthogonal basis of the vector space. Okay. So both of these are actually very, very easy to prove. And those who have taken my quantum mechanics class know how to do that, but there are many of you who have not. So let me just show you the proof. It's straightforward. So we have some state psi with eigenvalue lambda, right? Now what I do is I want to use this this Hermitian property. So they are called Hermitian, and they are also called self-adjoint, right? Because the operator is equal to its own adjoint. And so I want to use this adjoint property, right? So let me take the adjoint of both of the above expressions, right? What will I get? We'll get lambda star, adjoint get psi. Okay. Now I can take the, now I take the inner product of both of these equations. So I take the inner product of this, the left hand side of these two equations and the right hand side of these two equations. No, am I saying that right? One second. Yeah, no, I take both of these and I contract both of these on the left with psi. Okay, so from the first equation I get psi a psi is equal to lambda, right? Norm of psi. On the second equation I get psi Hermitian adjoint of A psi is equal to lambda star. Oh, so my bad. This one I have to contract with ket psi, not with adjoint. Okay. Now I can use the adjoint property. So the adjoint property tells me that A dagger is equal to A, right? Since A dagger is equal to A, I can write this expression as the expectation value of A. And then from the previous result, I have that this is equal to lambda times the length of psi, right? So I compare these two. What this tells me is that lambda is equal to lambda star, which implies that lambda is real. Okay. All right. So I'm rushing through this a little bit because I don't want to get bogged down too much in mathematical derivation. And if you're really interested in knowing this, you can read through this and work it out. So this is the first property, that they have real eigenvalues. The second property is that the eigenvectors of a Hermitian operator form an orthogonal basis of my vector space. Okay, so what that means is that I have some operator A, right? And let's say I take any two eigenvectors. I have one eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda and another eigenvector. Now I'll call something else, let's say mu, and another eigenvector with eigenvalue nu. Okay? These are two eigenvectors and there can be more, right? Depending on the rank of this operator. So what I want to show is that for any two eigenvectors, right, if I take the inner product of any two eigenvectors, it is going to be zero, right? This is the first thing. So if this is true for any two eigenvectors of A, right? So if this is true, then that will mean that I have some set of eigenvectors of A psi n, and these eigenvectors all satisfy this if I is not equal to j, right? So this will immediately tell me that I have, if I find the eigenvectors of my Hermitian matrix, I get n vectors which are all perpendicular to each other, right? That is a basis by definition. So I just have to show that this is true. Okay, so how can I do that? Well, again, I start with my assumption, which is this, and okay, then let me put this over here actually. Then I take this guy and contract here on the left with phi, and I take this and contract on the left with psi. Okay. So here I get phi a psi is equal to mu times phi psi. And on the second line, I get psi a phi is equal to mu psi phi. Okay. Now, here's the thing. Remember that the inner product has the property that if I switch the two vectors, I get a complex conjugate. Okay, and in case you are forgetting where this comes from, remind yourself the following, that the inner product is V1 star W1, V2 star W2, Vn star Wn, right? Right, and then you can see that one is the complex conjugate of the other. Okay, so now in this expression, right, what do we have? We have that if you look at the first line, we have phi a psi is equal to mu times phi psi, right? And the second expression has psi phi, right? So this is the complex conjugate of phi psi, right? So what I do is in the second expression, I take a complex conjugate, right? So I take the complex conjugate in this of the second expression. So I have psi a phi, and I take the complex conjugate. When I take the complex conjugate, what do I get? I get phi a adjoint psi. Okay. So if you have an operator sitting here, you have to take the adjoint. But this is equal to the operator itself because of the Hermitian property, right? So this is the left hand side of this equation, complex conjugated. And the right hand side complex conjugated is mu star phi psi, right? Okay, and what do these two expressions, so the first expression is this, and the second expression is this statement, right? So from here and here, right? These two are the same now. This tells me right that mu times phi psi is equal to nu star times phi psi. Okay. Now this is only possible if phi is equal to psi, because then mu is equal to nu. Right? And if they are different, if they are not the same, so if phi is not equal to psi, then this is only possible when the inner product of phi and psi is zero. Right? So this is the proof of the second property, that any two eigenvectors of a Hermitian operator are orthogonal, right? And this gives me a complete basis of my vector space. Because I have n orthogonal vectors, if I have n orthogonal vectors, I get a basis, right? I can just normalize each one of them and I get my basis. So Hermitian operators are very nice for this reason. The first reason is that they have real eigenvalues, and the second is that you can take their eigenvectors and form a complete basis. Okay. Now we can talk about diagonalization. This applies not only to Hermitian operators, but to all operators. But first, let me just talk about this in the context of Hermitian operators, okay? So I take some Hermitian operator, okay? And I take its eigenvectors, which is some set of vectors, psi I, right? As my basis for my vector space X. So what are the matrix elements of this operator going to be in this basis, right? In this basis, the matrix elements of this operator can be written as psi I A psi j, okay? Now, remember that these are all eigenvectors, right? So A acting on psi j is equal to lambda j times psi j, right? So I can bring the lambda out and this becomes psi I psi j, right? And this object, this quantity is proportional to delta ij, right? So I can this is delta ij multiplied by something, some number c. So what this tells me is that aij, right, this matrix aij It's diagonal. Right? In this particular basis, the matrix A is diagonal. Right? Oh, sorry about that. So in this particular basis, the matrix is diagonal, and the diagonal elements are just given by the eigenvalues. Okay. And but if I have some other matrix, right, which does not have these vectors as its eigenvectors, right? So I can ask, there is some different matrix B with a different set of, with its own set of eigenvectors, right? In this basis, in the basis of eigenvectors of A, this will in general be not diagonal, right? Meaning not diagonal, meaning that it will not all only have non-zero diagonal. I can't say that, right? It's not diagonal in this given basis, right? Because these are not eigenvectors of this operator. So I can't use the argument which I just made. But let's say B has some eigenvectors and we'll call them phi I. Then in this basis, right? And again, B is Hermitian. Then in this basis, the matrix elements of B, and in this basis, I'll put a prime. The matrix elements of B will be diagonal, right? But the matrix elements of A, which I'll write as A prime IJ, these will not be diagonal because these basis vectors, phi, these phis are not eigenvectors of A, right? So the point is that given any matrix, as long as that matrix is non-degenerate means that the determinant of the matrix is not equal to zero, one can always diagonalize such a matrix. And this applies to all non-degenerate matrices, not just Hermitian matrices, okay? So one can always diagonalize the matrix. So in other words, you can always find a basis in which the matrix elements of this A are along the diagonal. And that is equivalent to solving the eigenvalue problem. Okay, so as an example, let's consider again the poly matrix, the Z matrix. It has two eigenvectors. Right, and in this basis, this matrix is diagonal. But the poly X matrix, in this basis, is off diagonal, right? So I can ask, what are the eigenvalues of this X matrix, right? So this has the following eigenvalues. There is a plus state, which I can write as 1 by root 2, 1, 1, and a minus state, which I can write as 1 by root 2, 1, minus 1. Okay, and this has eigenvalue plus 1, this has eigenvalue minus 1. You can check it. It's one line calculation. So these are the eigenvectors of the matrix X. Okay. Now what I do is I perform a change of basis. Okay. So instead of my basis elements, basis vectors as being up, down, I take my basis vectors to be the plus minus thing. Okay. Then what happens? In this basis, what will happen to X? X will become diagonal. Z will become not diagonal. Right? And in this basis, X was not diagonal. And Z was diagonal. Right? So this is what happens when you want to diagonalize the matrix. You have to find its eigenvectors and switch to a basis where those eigenvectors are the basis vectors. Okay. So the exercise that I will leave for you is find the matrix elements of X and Z in the plus minus basis. Okay. And also the linear transformation connecting the two sets of basis vectors. All right. And I want you to do the following exercises from the book. Well, ideally, you should be doing all the in-chapter exercises. Okay. Okay. So like I said, ideally you should be doing all the in-chapter exercises, but if you don't have the time or the motivation to do all of them, then I expect you to at least do the ones that I'm assigning to you. Okay. All right. Are there any questions?
Sir, when we wrote the equality condition for Cauchy-Schwarz, sir, I think that it should be that A is KB.
When A is equal to what? KAB, right? It's a
KB, yeah.
Yeah, so that's what I said. Now, when theta is equal to 0, that means when the two vectors overlap, right? When theta is equal to 0, that means the two vectors are linearly proportional to each other.
Right, sir. I think on the previous page, I think you wrote that A is equal to B is the previous page. I think you wrote that.
Yeah, sir. Sir, in that for triangle inequality, sir, the sign should be reverse, sir.
Oh, right. In the triangle inequality. Right. Yeah. Thanks for pointing that. Thanks for saying. And I suppose that this is not exactly the triangle inequality, but sort of reminiscent of that. Okay. All right. So let's see. Are there any other questions? No? Okay, so please don't leave just yet. I'm going to stop the recording.